Okay, the microphone was off. Starting again? No, starting again. Okay, I reviewed the last class and let's follow. Okay, so I showed you that we can, for example, define central terms. We discussed about that and we told that this is defined by the community, something organic, right? And then we start discussing that we can exploit the idea of relations, taxonomies, ontologies, right, to connect things, to tell that these things is the same thing of that thing. Then I showed you that we can also exploit that to tell this is more generic, is more specific, so we can build taxonomies on top of it, okay? Then I started to talk about RDF and OWL, okay? The basic thing is, RDF is a project. You must understand that RDF is a project. In some sense, it started more or less in parallel with XML, okay? So it's not something that waited XML finish to start, okay? It's something more or less in parallel, but to provide this stack, they in some sense try to align the things. So in the beginning, people consider it that they are related, but in fact there is no relation between RDF and XML. Are two distinct and different models with different purposes, okay? So the thing is, I showed you that in the semantic web context, we can get our RDF or OWL and map it to XML. We can do that to exchange RDF documents. But we can also, and this is becoming much more and more used, put in a database. Okay? In the past, we use a relational database, which are the best way to store RDF, because RDF is even more similar to relational model than to XML. Okay? But today we have the RDF databases. Okay, so Virtuoso is an example. You store RDF right in the database. Okay? And graphs are much, much better than any other model to store RDF, because RDF is a graph. So when I saw the first time a graph database, I thought, this is perfect to store ontologies. And I will kill all other databases, because it's for ontologies is I don't need even to map things, okay? There are another representation for RDF we call N-tree. N-tree is a representation proposed by Tim Berners-Lee, and is something light for human beings, so you can read RDF, and is a good representation to learn, and we use it here to learn RDF. But what you need to think is, RDF is a graph, and all these representations are what we call mappings or materializations or codings of RDF, okay? So let's see more foundations of RDF. So this, it means resource description framework. And why we call that? In the beginning, they consider RDF as a description approach. Okay? You must consider that ontologies in this epoch is still starting the idea. Okay? So it's not so well defined. For this reason, they didn't relate it yet in the beginning, RDF to ontologies. They consider it's something to describe. So you must imagine that I want to describe this book, Life of Dinosaurs, and I have this card. So I showed you already that we can transform it in a kind of graph. And in RDF, we can think it about triples. Okay, so we have each description in RDF is also a triple, which is the resource is something we want to describe, property, which is a property describing this resource, and value, which is the value of the property, okay? And we can also tell that the resources is the subject of the description, okay? The property is the predicate, and the value is the object of the description. We can use also that. And we read the triple as the book. For example, if we have the triple book, Life of Dinosaurs, author Horace, we read that the author of Life of Dinosaurs is Mr. Horace. Okay? So, and why RDF is a graph? Because the triple becomes a graph in which the first member of the triple is the resource, is a node. The second is an edge, a directed edge towards the value, okay? And the third one is the value. And so we may imagine that in the object-oriented sense, some people try to compare to the object-oriented approach, in which I can have, for example, you can think the resource is the object, the property is the attribute, and the value is the value, okay? So you think, okay, it's right, but what's the difference in the model? In the object-oriented approach, the object defines its properties. Okay? So, the object tells, these and these and these are my properties and my values. Okay? And here is the opposite. The property is attached to the objects. Okay? I show you that this is easier to see when we talk about the classes. In this level, it's hard to understand that. You will understand that better when we go to the class level. Okay? So, the resource must be something identified by an URI on the web. A page, a book, a car, and so on. Okay? Can be the entire address of something, or you can use, I showed that in XML, right? You can use the hashtag, right? You can use the fogueirinha, the, I don't know in English, is the scope, doesn't matter, to define inside the XML document something. And this is a value URI, right? Which you are describing. A thing that people doesn't understand is it's not necessary that the URI, it's not necessary to be resolvable. What I mean by resolvable? I mean that resolvable is, if you put the URI in your web browser, something will come. Okay? It will give you something, right? So in this sense, it's resolvable. If you ask to the server, it will give you something, right? It's not mandatory that the URI to resolve the URI. It's not mandatory. Why? Because it doesn't affect the model. The URI is just a unique identification universal system. Just that. But it's better to be resolvable. Why is better? Because when you get the URI, you can get more information. So it's better, but it's not mandatory. Okay? Do you understand that? So in this sense, I mean, I can get a huge amount of data, like billions of things, and give an URI to each of these items. Oh, but in this case, I must have a page for each item. No, you are not obliged to resolve that. You just use the URI to give them identifiers, okay? The problem is, the URI is something so well designed that you have the property. So it's not possible that someone else resolves. Only if someone else had get your... Yeah. I mean, for example, I am the owner of this specific URI here. Let me show you. Okay. You must be the owner in some sense. The owner in the sense that you control it. Okay. So I am the owner of this specific URI, and I'm happy with that. Do you have? You are owners of some URI. You must do that. You must go at home and tell. Okay. My plan today is be the owner of somewhere. And they have some compromise to maintain it lifetime. So I will die and you put in my testament. My URI will go to... So you see, it's resolvable, okay? But let's consider that this URI is mine, okay? So I am the owner and I control it, okay? Now I want to get all my objects, my home, and give to each of these objects an URI, okay? Okay, so I create something like numbers, and the logic is, the number is my URI slash the number. This is a valid URI. But it's not resolvable. If you put here, you not get anything. Because it's not resolvable, okay? But I control it. Yes, exactly that. Okay? In the sense that, because people think, okay, if I will get all my objects at home and give a number or a URI to each object, I must create a kind of home page to each object. No. It's not necessarily resolvable. Okay? You just use the mechanism to identify things. Okay? Everybody understood that? Okay. And even when you go to PURL, they have kinds of PURLs. And there is one specific for semantic web. And the reason is that they will allow these non-resolvable things. Okay? Something. Eu ouvi barulho. Não aqui não. Okay. The URIs will allow us to distinguish things. Right? So, for example, if I identify people by name, we can have doubts. Right? We can have two people with the same name. If I use URIs, for example, if you don't know, a male is an URI. So you have an URI. Your email is a valid URI. Mail to dot dot. Your email is a valid URI. Okay, so I can distinguish people even if, for example, they have the same name. And I can also unify things. Sometimes the same person has two names. I can use the URI to tell is the same person. Okay. So, by using URIs, we have the ways to do that, okay? Doesn't mean that people will do stupid things, right? But we have the ways. So URIs will give us the ways to do the things, but, I mean... Oh, but what happens if someone give the same URI to two things? This is what I call doing stupid things. I mean, it's not possible to avoid that, right? I have the meanings to do the right thing. Just that. The thing is, if each node, each resource has a new RI, you have this network in which you connect things, right, in specific spots. So, we have something we call a statement in RDF. And what is an RDF statement? The subject or the resource is identified by an URI. Okay? The property or the predicate is identified by an URI. And the value can or cannot be identified by an URI. If it's identified by URI, it can become a new resource and can be described by itself. Okay? So let's consider this case here. For example, I have this resource and the property creator, which is the connection here, is again a URI. And the value is a literal, so it's not a URI. Okay? Usually in RDF, people use the square to represent literals. Just kind of convention, but there is no standard. There is no UML thing in RDF, unfortunately. But usually the community use the squares or the rectangles to do that. Okay? So let's consider the thing. If your property is an URI, you can have a controlled vocabulary. You can have people telling which properties you can use and how they are defined. So, for example, Dublin Core. I mentioned that here last class when someone told me how we define who is the guy that you define. So, Dublin Core did the following. They the right thing to do that. Okay, so the question is, what about if I have two terms to the same thing? The right thing to do that is cabide and ombreira, or any term you use to refer to something, will not be used in your URI. So in the past, people did that. They used terms in the URI. The modern ontologists, they don't use terms in the URIs. Okay? Why? Because terms change. Okay? There are different languages, and sometimes people tell, okay, it's not like exactly that, it's that. So, and the URIs cannot change. So, you may imagine the following. For example, if you enter here, let's enter in the OpenSeq. Let's enter in the OpenSeq ontology. Okay. So OpenSeq OWL representation, has an OWL representation of psych. I think the psych, right? Psych is a famous what we call top level ontology. Okay, which is an ontology that tries to comprise the knowledge in the world. Okay? I will talk about that. So here you put, for example, money. So money is a concept, right? Okay, so it will go to the ontology and we'll find this is not the right way to go. I want to go in the ontology. So let's do the following. It's not the PsychCorp. Let's enter here. Semantic Web. This one is the right one. So let's put here money. Okay. So here you have several terms in the ontology. Okay, money, money bag, what you want, money laundering. Okay, let's see money laundering. Okay, money laundering, which is interesting, right? Okay, so it has each notion, each concept in the OpenSea has an URI, right? But look at the end of the URI, okay? You will not see any term there. Concept, and you have a kind of hash or hash number or something. And this is the modern way to define ontologies. So if you get, for example, gen ontology, they do like that. And why is that? Because machines, they don't need texts. They don't need nothing. They just need a number. It's just a point in somewhere. Okay? And then after that, you define edges to literals with the names you want in several languages. So you connect. You connect this. You see there? English aliases. Man had laundered. Man laundered. Money. You see? So here, you have what we call labels in RDF, which are the text for human readers. But this is a kind of edge, okay, to a literal with the label. Just it. It doesn't affect the URI. Okay? Okay, so what Dublin Core did? Dublin Core did the following. They created 15 properties. RDF properties. 15. Okay? Title, creator, blah, 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 and so on and so forth. So they created highly important properties. And they defined that. They published it. It's not something big. It's just a simple document with the URI of 15 properties. But this is an excellent idea, because everybody who wants to define a title of something uses the URI of Dublin Core. It becomes an universal vocabulary. If I go to any place, if I am a machine, I never saw this schema, I know nothing about that, but I go there and see the property title, I know that this is the title. This is the thing, right? And for this reason, properties are URIs to allow to create controlled vocabularies. And this is one interesting thing when you use graph databases. Okay? When you use graph databases, you don't have this kind of requirements, right? You put any label you want in the edges. Okay? But then, what you see? The problem is, okay, I can put any label, but I have several nodes here, and I want to tell that the title of this, and the title of this, and the title of this is that. So what happens when you have three labels? You see that? This is something that you just see when you don't have. So, for example, you have this node here, three nodes here, and the three nodes in my graph have title, for example. Okay, and what happens here? You become aware that the three guys are talking about the same thing, okay? But I don't have here a solid way to uniquely identify the role of the edge. You can use the label, but if you just think about the label, people can write in Portuguese, título in English, and so a label is a weak way to define things, right? So when you define your eyes in the properties, you guarantee that you can identify the role of the edges wherever they are. Right? Are you understanding that? And this is important because this is the way to differentiate. And people have difficulty on doing that. Differentiate. What's the difference of a simple graph and an ontology? This is the thing. So I am going with you from the graph towards the ontology. So you can understand. Because this is my work. I start on graphs. I just put everything on graphs. Just like without any concern. And after that, I can. And this is one thing I'm working now. I want to transform this graph in an ontology. And to transform it in an ontology is a graph transformation. It's just a process of graph transformation. Okay? So you may imagine here now, if my resource is an URI, and I told you that my resource is an URI, and my property is an URI, but also my value can be an URI if I want. And what happens when my value is an URI? It can be also described. So what happens is, you see, here we have one triple here. Resource, property, and value. One property. But since the value is an URI, it can be, in its turn, again, and you are a resource. So you have a second triple here. Resource, property, value. And you have a third triple here. Resource, property, and value. You see? So you have three triples. Three triples. You see? Everybody see these three triples? And it's becoming a graph. Okay? So by following this approach, we can produce an entire graph just connecting triples. And triples and this kind of graph is the essence of RDF. It's the machine language of RDF. And it's the power of this approach. So now, what happens when I started with RDF is that any kind of things that machines wants to read on the web, they go to the graph. They go there and they start to just browse the graph and start to find things going toward the graph. Okay, so here I just start quickly, and the next class I will show you deeply. But one thing is now. We saw just the machine language, which is the graph. But now, if you remember, I told you that we see the world as objects and classes. Do you remember that? And the important thing here is, this is the way we, human beings, understand semantics. This is the way we define semantics itself. Is the way we see the world. Okay. In the future, I don't know how many years, I hope I am dead there, but in the future the machines will get us and tell, now you are not necessary anymore, human beings, and now we will define a new semantics in the machine's perspective. And then they will fire light bulbs or fire light, how can I say, higher, light bulbs, yeah. I don't know, toward us, and you kill all the human beings, and then the class will be different. But until there, semantics is semantics from the human's point of view. And from the human's point of view, we think about classes and things. So, in the RDF, they have something we call schema. And the schema is the way We will define classes, taxonomy of classes, properties, and relationships. Afterwards, in the OWL, I will show you that this, the distinction between the schema and the data disappeared because it's in fact it's hard to define the distinction, the division line. Okay, it's hard to define that. So in some sense, what's a class? This is an old slide. I don't like this slide. I must change it. Because the class is not just a template. Okay? It's much more than that. It works as a template, but the class has a meaning, right? What's the meaning of the class? It's a generalization of several objects of knowledge. Okay? And the interesting thing I will show you in details in the next class is the way you use to tell that something is a class. It's a graph. It's the same graph. So everything is so simple. For example, I want to tell that this node, temperature, is a class. So I put temperature, UC. RDF type is an URI. From a controlled vocabulary defined by RDF. Okay? And the interesting thing, I don't know if I will have time to show in this class to you, because usually I go to this level when I just go give a discipline of semantic web. But the interesting thing is when you start to understand that RDF define itself. It's what we call metaclasses, meta. So I don't tell that now because it's too much for you. For just one class. But the thing is, the beauty of the RDF is that you define things as graphs. You tell this is a class. And if you want to define any hierarchy, for example, you want to tell that Celsius and Fahrenheit are subclasses of temperature, for example, you can just tell, okay, Celsius is also a class and is a subclass of temperature. Okay? So then you start to define what we call in RDF an schema, but in fact afterwards we will define that like an ontology. Same thing you can do is a property. Okay, you can just get a node, for example author, and define that its type is property. You see, I didn't show in the last slide, but not just that is RDF controlled vocabulary, but also that. This is defining RDF. So both things tell that this guy is a property. And then comes the catch. You see, now pay attention. What happens? Look to this guy, my author. Look to this guy here. Pay attention to it. Okay? What will happen to it? It now becomes a property. It comes here. Okay. So this is something that what happened here. You just wake up and tell what happened. I didn't got the idea. This is what happened. Okay. It's a kind of, I don't know how to define that in graph terms. I don't know if it's a metagraph or something like that. But in some sense, this node, which is my author, now, since it's a property, it becomes something that you can use in some kind of description. It's a way to create properties. Okay? Yes. Is the way to classify the edges, exactly. But it's just the beginning. Next class I show you can have sub-properties, you can have other things, and so on and so forth. Okay?